Good evening. My name is Shelley Sweeney. I'm the head of Archives and Special Collections here at the University of Manitoba. This is our 22nd annual J.B. Rudnyckyj Distinguished Lecture. Dr. Rudnyckyj was the founder of the Slavic Department in 1949 here at the University of Manitoba. And something that maybe some of you would not know is that he was also involved in the Royal Commission on Biculturalism and and bilingualism. Thank you. Biculturalism and bilingualism. And when the report came out in the 1960s, the report actually said that Canada was a bilingual country and that it was English and French. And Dr. J.B. Rudnyckyj wrote a minority report that said that, in fact, Canada was multicultural. And of course, many of you speak other languages, and so this was a very important aspect to include and really has come to define Canadian society. Most people consider Canada to be multicultural. So on behalf of the University of Manitoba Archives and Special Collections, the Slavic Collection of the Elizabeth Defoe Library, and the Department of German and Slavic Studies, I would like to invite my colleague to introduce tonight's speaker.
Hello, my name is Magda Blackmore, and I work in German and Slavic department. Dr. Serhii Plokhy is the Mykhailo Hrushevsky Professor of Ukrainian History at Harvard University and the Director of the University's Ukrainian Research Institute. In June 2013, Dr. Plokhy was named Walter Channing Cabot Fellow in the Faculty of Arts and Sciences. He has served on the advisory committees of the Kinnan Institute at the Woodrow Wilson International Center for Scholars in Washington, D.C., the Davis Center for Ukrainian and Eurasian Studies, and the Ukrainian Research Institute at Harvard. Dr. Plokhy also serves on editorial boards of journals such as Russian History, East European Politics and Societies, Harvard Ukrainian Studies, and the Journal of Ukrainian Studies. Dr. Plokhy is the author of 9 books, including Yalta, The Price of Peace, The Cossack Myth, History and Nationhood in the Age of Empires, and lately, The Last Empire, The Final Days of the Soviet Union, which was shortlisted for a Lionel Gebel Foundation Prize, as well as Pushkin House Russian Book Prize. The newest forthcoming publication is titled The Gates of Europe, A History of Ukraine, and I believe is to come out in 2015. Today's lecture is titled The Empire Strikes Back, The Fall of the USSR and the Russian Invasion of Ukraine. Welcome.
Well, thanks a lot. Thank you for this introduction. It's a great pleasure to be here. I already see in audience some people whom I didn't see for a while, my old friends. It's also very pleasant to be in a place where it's relatively warm and no snow compared to, compared to Boston. So I guess my main message today is that you live in a wonderful place. Maybe not always appreciating that, but believe me. Well, today's talk is really a combination of a number of genres in the realm of talking. On the one hand, it's a book talk, and it's based on the book The Last Empire, The Final Days of the Soviet Union. I understand that some copies are available over there. Paperback edition should be in May or June of this year. On the other hand, it's also an introduction, historical introduction to what is happening today in Ukraine, and I'll try to show the ways in which events of 1991 and events of 2013, 2014, and 2015 really related in Ukraine in terms of Russia's policies, in terms of relations between West and Russia in general. And from that point of view, the slide that you see here right now, it brings together these two themes: historical theme of events of 91 and disintegration of the Soviet Union, and the events of the last few years, and that is the annexation of the Crimea and the hybrid war in Donbas, which I call an invasion of Ukraine by Russia. When I was writing this book, it was a book of history. I'm a historian. Normally, I started actually writing on the 16th and 17th century. I felt a little bit unsure about writing about events so recent. The 16th and 17th century, all participants of events are safely dead. So if you got something wrong, there is no one around to tell you that. And if other scholars argue with your views again, then we are on more or less on par. Writing about events of 1990 and 91, it was really like walking on a minefield. But I looked at that project and I looked at that book as a book of history. By the time it was published, and it was published in May of the last year, and by the time the first review appeared here and also in Europe, I realized that that book wasn't really about history. It was a book introduction to our today's day, and that's how it was received by most of the readers, or at least by those readers who cared enough to write review or go on Amazon.ca or Amazon.com and leave comments on the book. There is a number of narratives of the fall of the Soviet Union and of the Cold War and of communism that I was trying to argue against in my book. So I'll first walk you through all these other theories that exist out there. I'll show how wrong everyone else is. And then I will try to present my own view and my own take on that, and we'll see whether you will actually accept it, whether you'll buy it or not. Well, the first really very, very deeply ingrained certainly in the United States of America vision of the events of 91 and fall of the Soviet Union, it's the vision that I call triumphalist vision. I'm not the only one who uses this term, in terms of American victory in the Cold War. And America, the United States of America, that means won the Cold War, but by wiping out from the map of Europe its main adversary, the Soviet Union. So that's the image of really Gorbachev and communism and Soviet Union capitulating in the face of American policy vis-a-vis communism and in the face of American victory in the Cold War. This narrative really didn't work for me, and probably it would be taken and is taken with a lot of doubt by those in the audience who are old enough to remember 91 and President Bush's visit to Kyiv in the summer of 91 and delivering Kyiv chicken speech. So the first question that I had, okay, there is this kind of a dominant narrative in American historical imagination, and then there are some of my own memories, and they don't work nicely together. So there was a problem there right away, and one of the questions that I asked and one of tasks that I was trying to achieve was trying to figure out what was happening there. Another, again, narrative that exists and is quite widespread is the idea that the Soviet Union fell because the Communist Party, actually, it was the end of the communism. The communism collapsed. There was Boris Yeltsin, who is portrayed here as the first secretary during his time as the first secretary of the Communist Party in Moscow, and that it was once he banned or suspended the activities of the Communist Party on the territory of Russia, then the Soviet Union fell apart because party was a glue, and there was, as long as there was no party, there was nothing to keep the Soviet Union together. And again, for me, that didn't work nicely because that didn't explain why Estonia became independent and Chechnya was trying to be independent but never managed to do that. If the Communist Party collapsed everywhere, why still some of the republics became independent and others didn't? Another narrative is a kind of a personal story of everything would be okay and everything would be fine with the Soviet Union. Especially this view is widespread in Russia. But there were these two personalities. There were Gorbachev and Yeltsin, and they were at each other's throats. And it was the personal conflict between the two that explains the end of the Soviet Union. Well, if you buy into this argument, what that means is that those who wanted the Soviet Union to continue, and we now know for sure, he stated that more than once, the current president of Russia, Vladimir Putin, certainly was among them. So if you wanted the Soviet Union to continue, or if you want the Soviet Union or some incarnation of it, some form of it back, then what happened in 91 was just an accident, because there were two guys who couldn't talk to each other and hated each other and were trying to undermine each other. So if we now change a little bit people at the very top, then we can rewrite the history. We can do that, we can go back and do that right from that point of view, from that perspective. Well, my argument is, so in case you agreed with any of these arguments, they were all wrong. So now, unfortunately, the most interesting part of the book is done. So once you proved that everyone else is wrong, then it becomes much, much less interesting. But still, you have to produce the book, and they wouldn't publish it if it's just only criticism. I'm trying to argue in this book, and this is part of the story that certainly resonates with my own memories about what was happening in 91. And I think will resonate with the memories of many in this room. And this is, I am bringing back into the story, into the center of the story, Ukraine and Ukrainian referendum of December 1, 1991. Which actually is not there even as a footnote in any of these dominant narratives, either the end of the Cold War, where the main hero is President Bush, or the end of communism, where the main hero is Boris Yeltsin, or the conflict between Yeltsin and Gorbachev, where the focus is on Moscow. So what was left out of that was not of the narratives that exist or are dominant on the fall of the Soviet Union is not just Ukraine, but republics in general. And that was one of my tasks, actually, to bring these major players back into the picture. Ukraine gets most of attention, but I also write about Belarus. I'm also write about Kazakhstan and about Uzbekistan and the importance of the Baltic states, which are really crucial, where the story of the disintegration of the Soviet Union started with declaration of independence of Lithuania in March of 1991. And one more thing, and this is a broader framework in which I try to look at the end of the Soviet Union. Well, speaking about broader frameworks, fall of communism is one of them, end of the Cold War is another, and all of these are parts of the general background and important factors into the story. But it seems to me that the most important factor in the story of the end of the Soviet Union is this broader context that is not just limited to communism, is not just limited to the end of the Cold War, but look at the history of the 20th century in general. If you look at the map of the world before World War I in 1914, and you will look at the map of the world today, today we have something like between 190 and 200 countries and states. There was one third of them, maybe one quarter of that number at the beginning of the 20th century. So the 20th century, in general terms, there are terrible wars, World War I, World War II, Cold War, there are communism and Nazism and nationalism and all other things. But if you look at the map, the major story is really the story of the fall of the empires and emergence on their ruins, independent countries, Canada, one of them. Ukraine is another example of that. These are all parts of the same story. At Yalta, Canada and Ukraine get to be the founding members of the United Nations and members of the General Assembly and so on and so forth. And most of the world, in terms of its sovereignty, in terms of its independence, in terms of its state building, started to appear on the map of the world, geographic map, political map, whatever map, really in the 20th century. And that is one of my arguments. I'm trying to look at the Soviet Union into the context of the fall of the British Empire, of the Ottoman Empire, of the Habsburg Empire, Portuguese Empire, French Empire, and so on and so forth, which gives you a little bit different perspective on the process itself, on what happens after the end of the empire. And one of things that really struck me from that point of view was the question of why did it happen so peacefully? You look at the long process of disintegration of other empires. The Ottomans, that lasted for a number of centuries with never-ending wars, and to a degree the echo of the disintegration of the Ottoman Empire we had at the end of the 20th century in Yugoslavia. You look at British in Africa. You look at certainly Habsburgs who disintegrate in the middle of the major war. It was different with the Soviet Union. Everyone was surprised. It was a major superpower with the potential to really destroy half of the world, and then it just implodes. True, there was a war in Chechnya that actually started right away, already in November of 91, but on the grand scale of things, you look at that and what could happen. There was little of this worst case scenario type of things that really happened. So that was also the question of why that was issue. The question that is really closely related to what is happening today. Because I told you that when I was writing the book, I was writing a work of history. I was completely sure that the pages turned, that the disintegration of the Soviet Union is kind of an exception from the rule, where there is little bloodshed and there is little conflict. Well, what we have today is actually a continuation of the same story. The empire is not completely dead, and that actually goes to the title of my talk about Empire Strikes Back. Now, why did it happen relatively peacefully back in 1991? Well, again, probably some of you at least remember the news about coup in Moscow in August of 1991. And again, the expectations were that probably what would happen was that the old empire was back, that the communism was back, that the drive of Baltic countries and Ukraine and other countries for independence would be crushed, the drive of the Russian Democrats led by Yeltsin would be crushed, and so on and so forth. And it didn't happen that way. The army, the plotters brought the army on the streets of Moscow. And that was not the first time that they actually were trying to stop the fall of the Soviet Union with the help of the military, with the help of the army. The army was used in Tbilisi, in Georgia. The army was used in the Baltics. And now that was another kind of a new case of where army was brought to solve the political problems of the crumbling Soviet Union. But the army refused to shoot. Army was largely Slavic and largely Russian. They were shooting in the Baltic states, shooting at Lithuanians, at Estonians. The army refused to shoot in Moscow. The three people who died in the conflict were not attacked by the army. They attacked the army, and in the commotion that was created, the soldiers opened fire and they died. Well, in Moscow during the coup, what happened was that there emerged two centers of power and two legitimate centers of power. General Lebedev, who was sent to White House by the plotters to really encircle the White House with Yeltsin in it, told Yeltsin that if you want army on your side, you have to declare yourself to be the commander-in-chief of the Russian army. So what you saw in Moscow during the coup was really a conflict between old Soviet loyalties and new Russian loyalties. Yeltsin was saying that he was protecting the interests of the Gorbachev. He wants Gorbachev back. But in reality, what was happening, it was not the Soviet Union that was able to defeat the coup. It was the new Russian rising identity and the split loyalty within the leadership of the Soviet armed forces that resulted or brought about the failure of the coup. Here is Yeltsin. In the background you see the Russian flag that at that time was not yet official flag of the Russian Federation, but becomes after the coup, and it is in the name of Russia that Yeltsin defeats the coup. What happens after Yeltsin's victory is that Gorbachev is back, and he told his advisors when he was on the plane flying back from the Crimea, when he was interned back to Moscow, that we are now going back to a very different country. He couldn't really imagine how right he was in that sense, because the country was changed. The person who was running the show now was Boris Yeltsin. And what you see, if the events of the coup were covered all over the world, and I just tried to bring back some of the memories about that. What happened after the coup was actually not less dramatic, but the events were happening without tanks on the street, and there was very little coverage. There was a counter coup. Now the power was taken away from Gorbachev, not by the plotters, but by Boris Yeltsin himself. On this day, when Gorbachev came back to Moscow, it was 22nd of August, 1991, he should decree appoint a new Minister of Defense, new Minister of Interior, new minister, new head of the KGB. The next day, he was forced by Yeltsin to actually cancel these decrees and appoint people who were personally loyal to Yeltsin. So what you see happening at that time is the Russian leadership is trying to take over the Soviet Union. And Yeltsin replaced Gorbachev. Something that really didn't sit well with a number of republics. It didn't sit well also with the United States of America and President Bush. So I'll start with the American position, and then I'll talk a little bit about Ukraine and about other republics. Well, in the White House, they couldn't stand Yeltsin. He was boorish. He was unpredictable. He would play prima donna. He would come to the White House, and allegedly they were bringing him through a wrong entrance, and he would not do that. And they liked to work with Gorbachev. They got in the Soviet Union a junior partner on the international arena, and they want Gorbachev to stay in power as long as possible. They were getting actually from Gorbachev a lot of what they wanted to get in terms of the cuts to the nuclear arsenals. They were getting a lot in terms of the dealing with the regional conflicts. Middle East, Soviet Union was withdrawing support from the Organization for the Liberation of Palestine. In Afghanistan, the Soviet Union was withdrawing support from the Soviet-backed regime of Najibullah. Eventually, in the fall of 91, you see that Soviet Union cuts support for Cuba. So that was an ideal partner, a junior partner in the international arena that that the United States wanted to keep going as long as possible. So Bush's Chicken Kiev speech from that point of view was not just a gaffe, was not a mistake. That was the official position of the White House. Baltic states that whose inclusion into the Soviet Union was never recognized by the West and by the White House should go, but the rest of the republics, including Ukraine, should stay. So in August of 91, Bush told Ukrainian parliament that, well, he and the United States were against suicidal nationalism, and that it would be a big mistake to confuse freedom with independence. That these are different things. So that policy was in place all the way up until 1 week before the Ukrainian referendum of December 1st, 91. So what went for that was personal loyalty to Gorbachev, and he was a person with whom Bush could do business. There was idea that actually the Soviet Union, as long as it exists, the United States can get a lot of geopolitical advantages out of that relationship. And then third, last but not least, was the concern that actually the process of the disintegration of the Soviet Union would not be peaceful, that things could get out of hands. And Gorbachev kept saying again and again that what that can lead to would be a Yugoslavia with nukes, the kind of Yugoslavia war between the republics, but armed with nuclear arsenals. And that was really very high in terms of the American concerns at that time. So the US is trying to keep the Soviet Union going as long as it is possible. It would happen later that they would take credit for fall of the Soviet Union. But the fall of the Soviet Union from that perspective was failure of the policy that they actually pursued at that time. Now, going to the republics and to Ukraine in particular. Normal interpretation of what happened in Ukraine on August 24th, 1991, was that Ukraine declares independence from the Soviet Union. And that's exactly what is stated in very short, but very clear, formulated declaration on independence of Ukraine. When you put that into the context of what is happening in Moscow after victory of Yeltsin, And after return of Gorbachev, is that the de facto Ukrainian independence is not independence from the Union. It is triggered, and that's why the communist majority votes for it as well. It's triggered by the concern that instead of quite weak Gorbachev at the center and the Soviet Union that was liberal and disintegrating, it was the Russia that was taking over control in the center. So de facto, that was a declaration of independence from Russia. And you can see that right away in the way how Russia reacts to Ukrainian independence. Before the end of August, you see the first statement saying that if you are serious about this independence, then Russia has the right to renegotiate the borders. And this is for the first time that Crimea is mentioned and Donbass is mentioned. And that was a major reversal of the Russian policy, because before that, Yeltsin was together with Kravchuk and with Islam Karimov of Uzbekistan and others pushing for as much freedom from the Union as possible. Ukraine adopted resolution on sovereignty in 1990, only after Russia did that. So Yeltsin, as long as existed Soviet Union, he tried to get as much power, as much control over Russian resources as possible. But the coup changed the whole dynamic. Now Yeltsin was trying to play Gorbachev, and he was trying to show to the republics that he is not kind of a soft liberal leader. He immediately went for the threats for the territorial integrity of Ukraine and Kazakhstan. And the delegation was sent right away to Kyiv in late August of 1991 to deliver this message that if you are pushing too far, be prepared that the territory of Ukraine will be partitioned. Ukraine declares independence, and within 1 week, every other republic of the Soviet Union, dominated not by democratic majorities like it was the case in the Baltics, but by the communist majorities, follow Ukrainian example and declare independence from the Soviet Union. Within 1 week. And Yeltsin and Russia, they back off. They start talking about confederation. Confederation was a dream of the Ukrainian leadership led by Kravchuk before the coup, but stopped being that dream after the coup. After that, the question of full independence was put on the agenda. But in September and October of 91, Yeltsin tries to make a deal with Gorbachev, that there would be a confederation, which would be really run by Russia, but there would be this confederative facade, and the leader of that confederation will be Gorbachev. And that's where really the clash between the two personalities came to the fore. It was because Gorbachev couldn't imagine the situation where he would be actually following the orders, de facto orders from Gorbachev, and basically serving as a front to him, and that falls apart. But we have very interesting memoirs about the way how these negotiations were conducted. And the Russian side, represented then by Burbulis, Gennady Burbulis, and Sergei Shakhrai, who were very close to Yeltsin at that time, were saying that, well, here is the situation. At this point, we don't have enough resources and don't have enough money to keep supporting and funding the republics. And first and foremost, they were talking about the Central Asia and Central Asian republics. Russia needs time so that we would spend our oil and gas revenue on us, on Russians. We need time to rebuild ourselves. And the republics, they will come back in 20 years. And if they don't come back, well, not a big loss. It's important to keep those that are on our borders. You look at the Soviet Union and you realize that it seems to me out of 15, 13 republics were on Russian borders. So the vision was there quite early on that actually Russia needed time to use these resources to rebuild itself, but it never gave up on this idea of really some form of control or domination over the post-Soviet space. On this slide, you see Margaret Thatcher, and then on the other side is Igor Gaidar, the architect of Yeltsin's reforms. And it was he who formulated in economic terms this idea that Russia, in economic terms, has to go its own way. That there was no money to keep the empire going and running. There has to be another formula. And from that point of view, Russian democratic leaders, including Gaidar, they certainly look at the example of the fall of the other empires. Every other empire, you look at British, you look at French, they eventually stop their existence because they figure out that in financial terms, empire is actually a very costly enterprise. In the 19th century, maybe at the beginning of the 20th century, you can benefit from having an empire. In the second half of the 20th century, you're losing. And that brings me to the question that I formulated at the very beginning, why we see a relatively peaceful disintegration of the Soviet Union in 91. Well, the reason was that if you compare the Russian situation, the situation of any other empire at the moment of disintegration, the British, the French, the Portuguese, by losing colonies, they're losing easy access to cheap resources. Now look at Russia. Russia leaves the empire taking with it oil and gas repositories. If in 1917, 1918, during the Russian Revolution, Lenin was saying that without Ukrainian coal, without coal from Donbass, Russian revolution is dead, now the Russian liberal revolution that was envisioned by Gaidar would be better off if Russia would be on its own, if oil and gas would not be spent to support either Kyiv or Almaty or Bishkek or any other capital in the Union. Well, Yeltsin embarks on the policy of reform. He is convinced by his young advisors that if he doesn't do something drastic, the situation, economic situation, was so bad that in 6 months he would have the same rating as Gorbachev had in mid of 91. So he makes a deal with the parliament that for 1 year he takes over completely control over the government. He became not only president but also prime minister. And that the parliament would have no right actually to try to stop these reforms. The idea was that it will be very difficult, but it will be 1 year, and within 1 year the reforms will bring results and successes. Of course, it didn't happen that way. Now, going economically it's on its own, without other republics, was one thing. Going politically on its own and destroying the Soviet Union was a different thing. And there, Russia actually was trying still to maintain the Union in one way or another, in one form or another, either confederation or reformed Union, the way how it was envisioned by Gorbachev. But Ukrainian referendum changes the situation in the Soviet Union and in terms of the attitude toward the Soviet Union all over the world. When Ukraine declared independence in August of 91, Gorbachev's position was, it doesn't matter. In March of 91, I had a referendum on the future of the Soviet Union, and 70% of people in the Soviet Union and roughly 70 in Ukraine said that they want to live in the Soviet Union. Your Ukrainian parliament can make whatever decisions it wants, but it can't override the referendum. And that was one of the reasons why the Ukrainian parliament not just voted for independence, but also a referendum was put on the agenda and was put together with the forthcoming presidential elections, which were scheduled for December 1, 1991. Well, it was a gamble. No one knew how Ukrainian people would vote. And it was a gamble for Kravchuk and people around him as well. But by mid-October, they started to get first polling data on the attitudes in Ukraine. And the data that they got was that they were very likely not only to get to 70% for independence, but actually get more than 70%. And in mid-October 91, Kravchuk stops coming to Moscow to the meetings on the new Union Treaty that were conducted there by Gorbachev and that were attended by Yeltsin. So in Ukrainian referendum, they got 90%, including in every region. And when the three leaders of Slavic republics, and this is Yeltsin, Kravchuk, and Shushkevich, got in together in Belavezha, the negotiations started with Yeltsin putting on the table a new union treaty prepared by Gorbachev and saying to Kravchuk, would you please sign? Kravchuk said, it's impossible. There was a referendum. It's not on the table anymore. Yeltsin's position was, if Ukraine is not signing, then Russia will not sign either. And this is an interesting entry point into a question about, there was no referendum on the dissolution of the Soviet Union. There was referendum on independence of Ukraine. And Yeltsin and Gorbachev were saying, okay, according to the constitution, republics are free to leave the Soviet Union. You don't have right to dissolve the union. So how could it happen that Ukrainians voting for independence decided that not only for themselves, but also decided the independence for Russians and for Kazakhs and for others? What is the connection there? Why did it work that way? Well, frankly, when I asked some of my friends this question, they said, well, Ukraine is an important country, of course, how the Soviet Union could exist without Ukraine. But what that meant practically? Well, Boris Yeltsin, according to data that the materials that I studied, at least twice explained that to President Bush. One in telephone conversation, we have now the transcripts of conversation, and another in personal meeting in Moscow. But his position was that, well, Ukraine should be part of the Union, because otherwise Russia will be outvoted and outnumbered by Muslim republics. For me, that came as a shock. It's this kind of a thinking post 9/11, that was at least the formula that Yeltsin brought to Bush on more than one occasion. Well, the explanation is that it was very clear in Moscow that empire, in the way how it existed, in the form of the Soviet Union, was a major drag on the finances. So for Russia to keep empire going without support of the second largest economy in the Soviet Union was certainly not something that Russia was prepared to do. So Russia would not sign because Ukraine is not signing. But then all other republics, Central Asian republics, that depended in terms of the subsidies, with the exception of Kazakhstan, every other republic depended on subsidies from the center, from Moscow. So no reason to be members of the Union where there is Gorbachev and there is no Russia. That was the position of Belarusians and others. So what you get is kind of a chain reaction that starts with the referendum of December 1st, 91, and then leads and influences the decision of Russia, and then influences the decision of every other republic. So within 1 month, less than 1 month since the Ukrainian referendum of December 1st, 91, the Soviet Union stops to exist. Now, we have a very specific date when the Soviet Union comes to an end. This is December 25th, 1991, when Gorbachev goes on TV and says that he resigns as the president of the Soviet Union. A few hours later, President Bush leaves Camp David, comes to Washington, goes on TV, and declares American victory in the Cold War. A few hours before that, the White House released a statement where it praised Gorbachev for being a partner in ending the Cold War. But by the end of the day, there is a very different statement treating his resignation as the sign of American victory. That was going against the way how the administration, the American administration, was talking about the Soviet Union and its ability to influence situation there through most of 1990 and 91, when they were saying that, okay, really, there is relatively little that depends on us. The only thing that we can assure is that try to assure that the disintegration would be happening peacefully. So why this happened? Well, that happened in the middle of the presidential campaign, with President Bush lagging behind in polls, and that became one of the main themes in his presidential campaign about winning the Cold War by destroying the Soviet Union, and that's the origins then of this belief in America wanting the end of the Soviet Union and actually bringing the end of the Soviet Union. Gorbachev protested. Bush explained to him that, well, don't pay too much attention to what we are saying in presidential campaigns. But again, the narrative that was born there is actually the narrative that continues still today. Going back to 25th of December of 91, so we have a date when the Soviet Union ended, whether it was end of the Cold War, whether it was American victory or it wasn't, but there is a date. Well, in reality, this is the date of the formal end of the Soviet Union, but the date also only of the beginning of the disintegration of the USSR. In relatively recent speech, now it's 1 year already passed, on the annexation of the Crimea, President Putin said that, well, we in Russia believed that when the Soviet Union came to an end, that the Commonwealth was just another name for the same state. It's only when we realized that Crimea is on the other side of the border that kind of the reality started to dawn on us. Well, it wasn't only Putin who believed that Commonwealth is just a different name for the Soviet Union. So it took almost 10 years, the entire 1990s, for the process of really what in Kyiv called civilized divorce to take place. And it included a number of elements and a number of factors. One of them was the nuclear arsenal, which as a result of events of 94 were shipped from Ukraine to Russia, with Ukraine not getting guarantees but assurances about its sovereignty and indivisibility of the territory. And now if you talk to lawyers and especially people who specialize in international relations, they will say that assurances are not guarantees and assurances guarantee nothing. But That was certainly an important part in this solution of the nuclear question and important part of the dissolution of the Soviet Union. It was only in 1999, the last year of President Yeltsin's in power, that the Russian parliament voted on the law on the Russian-Ukrainian borders. According to the agreement that was signed in 97, Russia was getting military base in Sevastopol and was recognizing Ukrainian borders. It took 2 years for the Russian parliament to actually vote on this law. So it's only in 99 that we see actually finally, in terms of international law, issues of nuclear arsenals, of division of the property, of recognition of the borders, and so on and so on, resolved. So the fall of the Soviet Union and disintegration of it, this is the process that didn't end in December of 91, but really took almost another 10 years and really come to an end only in 99. Well, you see there a new leader of Russia emerging from behind the first president of Russia, Boris Yeltsin. And with Putin, we see major changes in the Russian foreign policy, especially vis-a-vis Ukraine and other post-Soviet space countries of on post-Soviet space, in post-Soviet space. But they don't come immediately right away. And in what Putin doing is actually a lot of continuation between the policies of Yeltsin and then the policies of the of his now his third term and his third rule. So there is a big temptation to explain everything what is happening today through just looking at Putin and saying that he is crazy and it's unpredictable what he would do. But there is also a lot in terms of what is happening, that the seeds of that, the beginning of that, are really in 1990s and in 1991 as well. Well, one of these things is that I interviewed a number of American diplomats and they said, well, in the 1990s, Russians were really very accommodating when it comes to the American foreign policy. So they were trying to almost kind of outdo Gorbachev in terms of this relationship. But there was one exception, and that exception was post-Soviet space. There, from the very beginning, the position of the Russian Federation was that West should recognize special right of Russia to be really dominant force economically, politically, militarily, and otherwise in the post-Soviet space. Peacekeepers should be Russian or Russia-led peacekeeping mission and so on and so forth. So the idea that actually the Soviet Union fell apart, but that the Russia was still a dominant force there and that no one else had actually right to be there, to interfere there, to support any movements that would be interpreted by Russia as going against its interests, was there already since the fall of 91. The Soviet Union was still there, but the idea that the republics would come back would be there. And you see that with the Orange Revolution, Russia is very actively takes part in elections, supporting bid for presidency of Viktor Yanukovych to the amount of $500 million. I remember on the eve of the elections being in Moscow, walking on the Tverskoy Boulevard and seeing the just big this billboard with the call vote for Yanukovych, and I thought, okay, I'm probably jet lagged, it's impossible. I'm in the center of Moscow, elections are taking place in Ukraine, why it is there? But that was one of the visible, in the center of Moscow, visible signs of really Russian involvement in that on a number of levels, financially, economically, politically, and of course trying to undermine the candidacy of Viktor Yushchenko, who was viewed and for good reason to be pro-Western. And there is a major, of course, disappointment on the part of Russia and a major fear that events like Maidan could happen in Russia as well. It is the time when in Russia they start to create these youth organizations like Naše or Ours and start to put money and pour money also in this fake NGOs supported by the Russian government and try to stop any Western funding for any NGOs that would be not controlled by Kremlin. But despite all of that, up until 2008, Russia follows more or less the policy that was really formulated first in 1991. And the policy was that the Union Republics of the Soviet Union have the right to go, but the autonomous republics of Russia should stay. So there were no attempt to send troops to Kyiv in 1991 to reverse the vote for independence. There was a delegation, but no troops. But once Chechnya declared independence in the fall of 91, that was the first time that the Russian troops were sent in November of 91 to Chechnya. And the war, then two Chechen wars and so on, was going on and on. Solzhenitsyn believed that that was a wrong war to fight because that was not about the Slavic world. Chechnya should be let go. The right war would be for Ukraine and for Belarus. But up until 2008, there was basically the policy that Russia is using with West keeping blind eye on that, using troops on its territory, on the territory of the Russian Federation, to crush Chechnya or any other possible threat to Russia's indivisibility and sovereignty. But what we see in 2008 is for the first time that the Russian army crosses the borders of the Russian Federation and enters into the territory of a sovereign state, in this case it was Georgia. The next, development that comes along those lines is the annexation of the Crimea and the war in Donbas. And with annexation of the Crimea, we have a crisis which is called the Ukraine crisis. But this crisis has actually a lot of meanings that go beyond Ukraine and significance for the world in general. Well, first of all, this is the first time since 1945, since the end of World War II, that a major European power annexes, not just invades country, we saw a lot of that happening, not just invades country, but annexes territory. Really, creating not just a threat to the international order, the way how it existed since the end of World War II, but really destroying this order, which creates also crisis in Europe and for Europe and for role of Europe in the new world, whether Europe is able to defend itself or not able to defend itself. The crisis for the United States and NATO and the role of United States and Canada in European affairs. It is also, of course, a major crisis in Russia, and Russian crisis per se. That's the origins of what is happening in Ukraine, and the future of Russia, and the former republics of the Soviet Union. Because with the doctrine that is used today about the right to defend Russians or Russian speakers or people of Russian culture anywhere without any limits, including Canada or United States, the question should be asked whether maybe Estonia can be next with Narva? Or what should expect Latvia? And these are the countries that are members of the European Union and members of the NATO. Iran and negotiations regarding the nuclear arms. After what happened to Ukraine, which got assurances and not guarantees, how many Gaddafis there would be around who would actually be prepared to exchange their nuclear programs or their nuclear arms for a piece of paper signed by a number of countries, in case of Ukraine, one of the signatories to that that agreement actually invaded the country. At the end, I want to say that my original conclusion, which went into the book, which is there, and which I tried to contextualize in the introduction that I wrote for the paperback edition, and that conclusion was about the peaceful or relatively peaceful fall of the Soviet Union, was premature. The story of the fall of the Soviet Union, the story of the fall of what I call the last empire, the last kind of a classic empire of the 19th and 20th century, unfortunately it is not over. And we don't know when and how it will end. But it is very clear that to a degree that Ukraine was important for the fall of the Soviet Union, Ukraine today is again at the center of events and is absolutely important for the fate of this project of the gathering back Russian lands or restructuring or reconstructing any kind of European Union or any kind of post-imperial state or post-imperial polity or union that Russia and in particular President Putin would like to create. So I will stop here. I still have a lot of pictures, so if you have questions, I'll show you more pictures. Thank you very much.
Okay, I know that probably some of you are anxious to ask questions, so if you'd like to ask our speaker a question, if you could raise your voice and maybe you could repeat the question just to make sure that everyone hears it.
Okay, sure.
Okay, there's over here.
Well, the question was about whether I have any inside information or views on the on the absence of President Putin for 10 plus days. And I was addressed as Dr. Plokhy. I'm not a medical doctor. So what I'm going to say really has nothing to do with that kind of analysis. Well, this is not the first time that President Putin disappears from public eye. Before that, statements were made that he has back problems. So whether that was one of those cases or not, I don't know. But his disappearance happened also at a very interesting time, not just in terms of Russian-Ukrainian war or Russian relations with the West, but also in what is going on in Russia itself. Because the killing of Boris Nemtsov in front of Kremlin, whatever theories are out there, one thing that is absolutely clear that this crisis that is called the Ukraine crisis is the Russia crisis or the Russian crisis in the first place. And what we see are certainly the cracks within the political fabric of Russia itself. And there are divisions within the ruling group. Judging by what happened now, it looks like that it was Mr. Kadyrov who was important part in this assassination. And it looks like that the freedom that Mr. Kadyrov was getting and is getting is something that the Russian security services are not happy about. So what we see are really conflicts within within the ruling group itself. And it's a direct outcome of the quote-unquote Ukraine crisis, sanctions, economic difficulties that are actually now start to become more and more profound in Russia. And Mr. Putin is 62 years old, so there is a lot on his plate right now, so I think that we can expect more disappearances in the future. Thank you. The question was about the comments that appear, especially to the articles here in Winnipeg and in other places, that basically more or less repeating Kremlin's line on the events in Ukraine and the this revolution of dignity and ouster of Yanukovych being illegal act. In the last few years, Russia and Vladimir Putin in particular presented their case not only as a case of this ideology that is called Ruskiy Mir, so the idea of defending Russians anywhere in the world, but also as a kind of a universal case of the defense of traditional values, which resonates very well with the right sectors of society in Europe and also in here in North America. And then also as basically Russia standing up to this big bully of the United States, which resonates very well with the sectors on the left. So Russia also pays a lot of money for people who are actually professionally comment on these articles. So there is a combination of number of either financial incentives or ideological incentives that certainly contribute to the kind of debate that we have on Ukraine here in Canada and in the United States as well.
Hi. I want to go back to what you said about Georgia in 2008. So you have Russia crossing the border of a sovereign state, a NATO candidate at the time. So the way I read into it, maybe you could comment on that as well, is Putin is saying, you sign these guys up, I'm going to test Article 5, so you guys think really hard about whether you're going to go to war over this. So my question is, why does that not trigger the sort of preparation or the kind of discussion that we're having today? Is it simply a fact of going east versus west? Or were there other reasons that you may, through your research, have a better insight of?
Well, one of the arguments that is made even today, not to 08, but today is repeated again and again, is that what Russia is doing is in self-defense, that NATO moved too close to the Russian borders, and that the Russia has to right to protect itself. That's the Russian argument, but that is also argument that we hear here in North America. Well, why the West didn't react then in 2008 and allowed Putin to get away with that? Well, the reason is that the West actually wanted the whole thing disappear even now. It's only the tragedy with the Malaysian airline that triggered real sanctions. So when Crimea was annexed, the sense in Europe was, okay, we can live with that as long as he is not going further. So it's almost amazing how well doesn't learn from experience of 38 and 39 a time like that. The argument regarding Russia reacting to NATO moving close to its borders and that's why it takes over Donbass or Crimea is completely false, because what happened in 2008 after the Russian-Georgian war was that the West said, okay, we hear you. Probably we got too far. The membership of Georgia and the membership of Ukraine in the NATO or the action plan is not on the table anymore. And what we see since 2008 is actually redefining of the rules of what is acceptable for Russia and what is not. In 2008, there was membership in NATO, but Putin said more than once, saying that, okay, if the countries want to join European Union, they can do that. Well, the events in Ukraine started not about membership in UN, that was in NATO, that was not on the table, was not on the agenda. Not membership in European Union, that was not on the agenda. That was, I'm sorry for the word, a lousy association agreement with the European Union. So it's really a completely different already vision and agenda that and the different kind of rules that Russia suggests West should accept. Yes, please.
I would just like to ask you to comment on what you think about if the so-called People's Republics are going to be satisfied with the territory they've seized, or if you think in 2015 there's going to be further aggression.
Well, I kept hearing for a number of time that what a terrible situation that we are going to get a frozen conflict. And I was saying, well, I'm praying for a frozen conflict because I believe that the chances that it will not be frozen conflict but hot conflict are very high. And they're very high because in my opinion, none of the tasks that President Putin wanted to achieve starting this adventure in Ukraine were achieved. The idea was to force Ukraine to join customs union and Eurasian Union. It doesn't look like this is on the agenda in the nearest future. More than that, Belarus and Kazakhstan that really were close allies and continue to be close allies of Russia now having second thoughts about getting too close to Russia. 2 days ago, Независимая газета published an article which was called Between Chechnya and Ingushetia about the subsidies from the federal budget to the Crimea, which are in billions of dollars, or not maybe billions, but close to that, and 85% of Crimean budget comes from Moscow. Chechnya, it seems to me 82 or 83%. So Crimea is more subsidized than Chechnya and a little bit less than Ingushetia. Donbass, it's a rust belt of the former Soviet Union. To make it work and pay its way, one needs tens of billions of dollars of investments. So relations with the West are really terrible. The only thing which goes well for Putin is that he is growing in support because he controls media. So in situation like that, if objectives are not achieved, the chances are quite high that he will try to push further. There is a question of access to the Crimea, the so-called corridor to the Crimea. There is a question of getting more territory for this republic so that they would be able to pay at least half of their own bills. Because otherwise, again, it's a major burden on Russia and on Russian economy. So I'm not very optimistic.
The West maintained the stand that Kennedy did in '63 with the Cuban crisis, draw the line earlier.
Well, the line. That Russia insists, and insists from the very beginning, is that the line should go on the borders of the former Soviet Union. And the voices are there that, okay, Russia historically is a great empire, a great state, and maybe America should accommodate Russian interests and not get into Russia's backyard and recognize Russian sphere of influence. And that actually argument that Russians are making. What is missed in this kind of thinking is that, well, it's not 19th century in the way that it's just great powers that decide what to do. It's people on the street and people in those countries in that region. They have the right to say at least something about their own fate. Events in Ukraine started because Ukrainians didn't want to agree that actually this the opportunity of them reforming society by getting into association with European Union, that opportunity was closed. And they went on the streets and they refused to leave the streets of Kyiv. So it wasn't really the great plan in Washington or in Ottawa or in Canberra or in Bonn or in Berlin or in anywhere else. But it's Ukrainians who went on Maidan who changed history and for themselves and for the rest of the world. So the thinking in terms of great powers having right to do this and that clearly doesn't work in today's world.
Okay, we'll just take one more question, Jim.
The question is that what is the chance that if Russian army is ordered into battle into Ukraine, what are the chances that the Russian army just would not shoot and would not do that? My understanding of what is happening and what was happening in Eastern Ukraine. In Crimea, the Ukrainian armed forces never received an order to basically resist in any way with arms. There was a number of reasons for them. One of them was that Ukraine had army on the paper, but in reality, it was not army that was able to fight either in moral terms or in terms of their readiness. But over the summer, Ukraine actually started to get its army that was learning how to fight. And at that time, by July and early August, the chances were that the two Donetsk and Luhansk republics, that they would be defeated. And it was at that point that the regular Russian army was thrown into the battle. How we know that? We know that some of them were captured, interviewed. It's now online. It was a major embarrassment for the Russian leadership. So my understanding is what is happening now is that it's not that the units are being sent there, but it's the individual soldiers or people who have expertise in this kind of that weaponry. They're kind of seconded from the Russian army to Donbas. The latest assessment from the Ukrainian side that I read was that overall the quote-unquote armed forces on the separatist side, close to 50,000, plus minus 10,000 of them are Russian military. What we know from the statements made by NATO, United States, and their intelligence, they confirmed that. So that's the information that I have.
Mm-hmm. Good.
Sure.
Okay, I know that there's still a number of you who probably have questions. Professor Plokhy will be here to you know, you can come up and ask him some questions. We do have some food if you didn't have time to grab supper. We also have a few copies of The Last Empire, The Final Days of the Soviet Union, which is on sale for $30, including tax. And you would sign these.
Yeah, absolutely.
He absolutely would sign these.
For no extra cost.
A bargain, a veritable bargain. You get to buy the book and you get to have it signed. So I'd just like to take this opportunity to thank you for a very stimulating and thought-provoking talk. It just shows you how much money really enters into things. And it's very nuanced and layered, all the relationships between all of the parties. So thank you very much again,
thank
and
you.
We really appreciate you coming out here.
Thanks a lot. Thank you.